everybody, it is Jamie from Jamie Ridler Studios, and I am here with an episode of Creative Living Bookshelf. Oh my goodness, I have some great books today. I always have so many books to read and so many books that I'm enjoying that it's hard to decide what to share. And I think I'm just going to have to start sharing on a regular basis and saying, here's what I'm reading. Maybe you'd like to enjoy it too. And I've got a bunch of nonfiction books. And you know what? I'm really excited by a theme that kind of ties them together. Everybody's book that I'm talking to you about today has been a guest on my podcast. And it has been a joy to talk to these creative people and to see how their ideas, their thoughts, the work they want to do in the world has come into the shape of a book. And the first one I'm going to share with you is The Muse is In, An Owner's Manual to Your Creativity by Jill Bodonsky. Now, I love the whole concept of a user's manual for your creativity. And you can see that Jill has gotten incredibly creative with how she's sharing the information in this book. It's visually very interesting, very dynamic. And one of the things I really like about this book is she addresses certain key trouble spots that you might recognize in your own creative life. For example, overwhelm. Have you ever had that experience? I certainly have. And so her sort of emergency response to overwhelm is to activate your overwhelm periscope. So right away, I love that image. It gives you the idea of getting above and beyond all that energy that you're swimming in. It's a great image. And one of the other things I really like about this book is, so a portion of it is dealing with particular problems that might get in the way of your creativity, and then there's a maintenance program in your user's manual. So the kinds of things you should do in January or February or March. So there's lots to sustain you here in with creative practices in your creative life. Jill Bodonsky, The Muse is In. So funny. I love how you see it in everyone, their energy, right? Jill's like, wow, like pow, pow, this sort of fun, creative, exciting, blah, energy to Jill in her book. And then Christina Rosalie, this beautiful, reflective, A Field Guide to Now, Notes on Mindfulness and Life in the Present Tense. Such a good time talking to Christina. She is really insightful, and I found her words in a live interview as poetic and evocative as the ones that are in her book. And her book is really beautiful also. Can you see how there's a different energy already? You can see I've highlighted a whole bunch of Christina's book. And what she does is tell these stories, these moments from her life, and then identify a theme from it, and then give us all a bit of a prompt of what to do. So the first one is action, and she tells a story. And then I love this. She gives a little postcard prompt to invite us to think about something and then to do something with our insight. And one of the things she said here is, this is the way things almost always begin. Innocuous and small. Jotted down on a napkin, a phrase that circles around in your head for days, a feeling you cannot ignore. This is when you must pay attention. This is when you must do whatever you can to begin. And that is exactly what she did to bring this beautiful book to life. I was really moved by Christina, and I've been very moved by the beauty, the tenderness, and the stories in her book. Another book that I am thoroughly enjoying is Drawing Your Life by Michael Knobs of Sustainably Creative. This book is filled with drawing prompts from your life. So like, treat yourself to a slice of cake, draw it. And it gives you space to do just that. It is such an engaging book and a really unintimidating invitation to start to draw. I find drawing very intimidating. But when I read this, like, set a timer and draw for 20 minutes, then take a break. I love that. And I really also felt very moved by many of his prompts, really encouraged personally by his prompts. Like here he has one where he says, don't be scared. Draw something you think you can't draw. It's just, Michael is so lovely, and it was a real pleasure to talk to him on the show, and it's a real pleasure to experience him through this book. This is kind of a thought I started to have when I was in graduate school, and I didn't have the best memory for this book by this person on this date at this time, you know, those kind of details. I would very much engage in and remember the ideas and the concepts, but not always who they were attached to and when. And so the idea I had at that time was to build a stronger relationship with the authors, to imagine them as people, because they are, but people that I know, people that I could chat with. And that's, you know, now I'm doing that, so that kind of amazes me. But it really helped me start to see that we, when we read a book, we are having a conversation with the author. And it can be a one-way conversation where we're just listening and absorbing. But as long as we're thinking and responding, I highlight everything. I write notes in the margins. And these days, you can even write to the author. So many people are available to you online. You know, they're very happy to receive an email that says, I love your book. And so I really encourage you to do that. Really think of these books not only as inspiration for your creative life, but that the authors are a part of your creative living cohorts, as my friend Jennifer Lee likes to call them. You know, they're a part of your team. They're a part of your creative living culture, and they've got something to share. And again, I just want to point out that one of the things I love about this is you really see the different personalities, the different viewpoint, the different vibe that each of these authors has. So also think about your vibe. Think about what you have to share. One of the people I know, lots of people dig Danielle's vibe. Another book I'm reading is The Desire Map by Danielle Laporte. I'm, of course, a big fan of Danielle, and I was so glad to talk to her on the show. It's exciting to see people actively engaging with this book. This is about connecting to your true desires and using those feelings as guides, as, you know, the constellations that you live your life by. And it's not about achieving X, Y, Z. It's about how can I generate these feelings that I most want in my life more and more and more. And one of the things I love about this is that as a coach, I really take a stand for, you get to taste the life that you want to be living now. And Danielle's book really takes a stand for that too. So if one of the things you really want to feel is joy, then how can you experience joy today? You know, if one of the things you really want to feel is blessed, that's on my list, blessed. How can you invite that in today? So I love that too. Danielle, of course, she's brilliant. Her words are like diamonds, concise, clear, thought-provoking. So anything she writes is usually really worth checking out. One of the, you'll probably see if you're on Pinterest or she has a Facebook group for this, the Desire Map as well. People are sharing in a multitude of ways what their words are that represent their core desired feelings. And what I did, because I always like to get creative, first I put them in my journal, and then I was like, I want to carry them around with me. I want to be a little more conscious of them. So I made a little, you know, I make dream boards and I make vision cards. So I just made this little inspiration card of what my desired feelings were. I picked an image that meant something to me, and then I just wrote on it. So mine were wild and free, wonderful. So I want to be full of wonder all the time. Beautiful, accomplished, alive, and blessed. And these are very related to my values too. But this is really, again, a way of actively engaging with the book and what Danielle is inviting us to do. So those are my nonfiction creative books, but you know, one of the things I've been trying to do for my creative life is to always have a fiction book on the shelf. So what I have been reading, just finished, oh, it's so good, Half-Blood Blues by Essie Edugian. I hope I'm doing reasonably well at saying your last name. This is a book, I wrote up the description because I found it hard to describe. And in a short sense, this is what they say about the book. Berlin, 1939. A young, brilliant trumpet player, Hieronymus, is arrested in a Paris cafe. The star musician was never heard from again. He was 20 years old, he was a German citizen, and he was black. This book is jazz, this book is war, this book is friendship, this book is art. This book opened my heart. It took me a little while to find my way into it, and then I started to see the complexity of what it was about. And I started to feel so strongly through the journey of the characters. And this book made me think. This book made me think about what it means to be an artist, what it means to be a friend, and what it means to be a good person. So I found this a very enriching book. And again, one of the things I did to engage with it is now in my journal, I often put in same thing, an inspiring page, and then a picture that grabs me, and then a quote, or if something else has been catching my ear, a line from a song, something somebody said to me, I put it here. And there's this moment in the book. Last Chip said, I tell you what I know. The world's damn beautiful, but it's an accidental beauty. What we do, it's deliberate. It's the one damn consolation you can offer not just your own life, but other lives you ain't even met. Touches me now just reading it, and it really made me think about the nature of art, the nature of contribution we make when we give ourselves over to creating something beautiful in this world. And that is what all of these authors have done in sharing their work. I hope there is something in here on my Creative Living bookshelf that is ready to find its way to yours. This is Jamie from Jamie Ridler Studios. Thank you so much for visiting my studio and checking out my bookshelf.